pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity we have to come into your house to worship you. We pray, Heavenly Father, that as we share in this moment of your word, may our eyes and our hearts be open and receptive. May your words fall on fertile soil, and may your word take root in our hearts and bear fruit in our lives. So may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Good morning, brothers and sisters.
Good morning.
The theme for this month is receiving the light. Christmas is all about the bright lights. So we'll be sharing for a few moments on light, on receiving the light, and what that means. The scripture lessons that was read earlier, Genesis and John, covered a lot of grounds. So we should get to the matter quickly. But I just want to flip to Genesis chapter 1 that was read earlier, just to look at something. We're talking about receiving the light. And when Genesis opens, that was the subject of the story. The story began with light. And Genesis 1, verse 1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void or empty. And darkness was on the face of the deep. So darkness was here before light. Are we okay with that? And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the heavens, or the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the deep. So there's darkness, the Spirit of God. And verse 3 introduced something in the story which a lot of us read, but we don't place a lot of emphasis on. Verse 3 says, and God said, let there be light. And there was light. What verse 4 says? And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. Let's pause a little bit. God said, and God saw. Obviously, we're not talking about an impersonal force here. We're talking about a person that sees and speaks. Are you with me? It seems to suggest to me that the first sign of life is intelligence and not a random, mindless, unguided process called evolution. How could the scripture know that intelligence was responsible for producing life? Hebrews says, by faith we understand that the worlds were created by the word of God, so that things which are visible were not made from things which do appear. Are you with me? Now, word or words, that's information. I'm speaking to you now, you're hearing what I'm saying, but you cannot see my voice. I'm using an invisible medium to communicate ideas and thoughts to you. Are you with me? I have introduced into the airspace something that is invisible. And oh, when the intellectuals take it, oh, you can't see God, so God don't exist. So you can't see my words, so my words don't exist. And something is invisible, it can have no impact on physical things. Then tell me about anger and hate and love. Can you see them? No. You can only see signs of them. Happy. Sad. Signs. So invisible things have to use signs to communicate to a visible world. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Keep your pen handy. So invisible things need signs to communicate. Companies and organizations know this. That's why they use signs or logos or symbols to communicate what they're saying. Are you with me? So, intelligence was introduced. God spoke, God saw. Invisible word was used and introduced light, which, by the way, is the basis of all life form. Now, something interesting happened in verse 4. God saw the light, that was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. Just pause. God divided the light from the darkness. It seems to me that when God appeared, it's light. But then God did something. He divided the light from the darkness. How is that possible? How is it possible to separate, to divide or separate light from darkness? Well, it seems to me that when God was moving over the space of the deep, over the waters, it means God is moving in what we call our atmosphere, called Earth. He divided light from darkness in a very simple way. Darkness was here before light. Now, darkness engulfs and absorbs. So, darkness doesn't travel, it engulfs and it absorbs. Light, though, travels and projects. Are you with me? In other words, light travels in a straight line. Are you with me? Work with me now. Light travels in a straight line. So if I have an object and I'm shining light towards the object, then anything that is behind or below the object, that is behind or below the line of light, will not be seen. It will remain in darkness. Are you with me? So when God came on the scene, He laid down the principle of light, that light must travel in a straight line. And in doing so, light was divided from darkness. And the evidence is clear. When the sun is shining, it can only shine on half of the earth. The next half remains dark. That's what it means. Get it? He divided the light from the darkness. It means then that God's light, the light of God, doesn't operate like the light of the sun. Because the light of the sun is limited. It can only travel in a straight line. God caused it to be so. Are you with me? But not just that. Have you ever wondered? The sun is what is called light years away from the earth. Now, all the space exploration that we've seen, when the space shuttle is in outer space, there is no light, it's all darkness. You ever wonder about that? But by the time the light wave hit our atmosphere, it becomes illuminated. Are you with me? So God placed the principle of light to be illuminated here in our atmosphere and set how it ought to operate. Are you with me? So the light is traveling from the sun, and between the sun and the earth's atmosphere is dark. By the time it reaches our atmosphere, the ever caused it to illuminate. Isn't that wonderful? And it explains again how light is divided from darkness. Because by the time it reaches our atmosphere, it starts traveling a straight line. I don't know how to define speed, 186,200 miles per second. But between the sun and the earth, we don't know how it travels. We have no clue. It's darkness to us. We don't have any light on that. We only have light on what's in our atmosphere. Are you with me? Brothers and sisters, are you okay? That's good. Now, if it gets a little heavy, let's take a breath. Now, light. Look at how light travels. Now, light. It says, scripture says that God created two lights to shine light upon the earth. Just hold that thought and let's just examine it. So, in day one, God said, let there be light, there was light, and God divided light from the darkness. Called the light day, darkness he calls night. That's day one. We've read all Genesis chapter 1, so I don't need to go into all details. But let us look at what happens on day 4, verse 14. Then God said, Let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and seasons, and for days and years. Pause. If you're a lawyer and you're looking at the evidence of the case, there's an anomaly right here. Why do I say that? Because it's already said that God said, let there be light. It already said that there was light, and God divided light from darkness. And now we are being introduced in day four to the creation of the sun. Simply means that the light that was shining on earth for day 1, 2, and 3 was not the light of the sun. And when the sun was created, the sun's job was not to divide light from darkness. It was to divide the night from the day. Are you with me? So the sun and the moon, they got a role, and their roles were to separate the day from the night. Why? Because day and night is operating on the principle of light and darkness. So God is going to delegate that responsibility to the angels. And he just speaks to the ever, and sun and moon and stars came. What a wonderful, awesome, magnificent God we worship. So God spoke, sun came. So let me just explain this to you now. So we're talking about the fourth day now. Now this is very, very important. Now if it's not the light of the sun we're talking about from day 1 to 3, then when it says the evening and the morning was the first day, you know, you can't talk about 24-hour day. Because the 24-hour day is governed by the sun. Are you with me? So the first day, the second day, was not your 24-hour day at all. Peter alluded to it in his epistle when he says, know that to God, one day is like 1,000 years to us. Brothers and sisters, God's ways and his thoughts are not always in it. If you are in a situation, you have figured it out. That is not it. God's ways are past finding out. His ways have to be revealed. Yeah. Amen. And he reveals the deep things of himself through his spirit. So here, we're introduced to the light of the sun. And the sun now got the role of ruling the day, and the moon to rule the night. But where did God place them to shine light upon the earth? It says, verse 17, God set them in the firmament of the heaven to give light on the earth. So that which is to give light to the earth does not dwell in the realm of earth. We're going to come up to it, receiving the light. God is trying to establish the foundation for you. So that which is supposed to give light to the earth is not on earth. It is from another space, from another world. It's in the heavens. And that which is in the heavens is going to give light to that which is on the earth. Are you with me? So if light is going to reach the earth, it has to come from somewhere else. Are you with me? That's how light operates. In fact, that's how we interact with light. If we want to use the lights, we have to put them above us, because we don't walk in the air. That's how light operates. We don't walk in the air. You want to use lights in your car? You have to put them on the front of your car, because you're not sitting on the front of your car. You and the light can't be in the same space. It's going to help you. Are you with me? And when we're using light, we either put it above us or before us. You can't put light behind you, otherwise you're casting a shadow. You're walking in darkness. Are you okay, brothers and sisters?
Yes.
Alright. So, having established that there is evidence of light, and that light in Genesis was not the light of the sun. The sun came after, 4 days after. Then the question arises, is there really a light separate and apart from the sun? The answer to that is given in verse 14, when God says, let them be for signs and seasons, for days and years. The word signs that is used, the Hebrew word, is oth, O-W-T-H. It means, this is what it means, the Hebrew word. It means to assent or to agree by appearing as evidence. So, the sign, the word sign there means to agree to something by appearing as evidence. In other words, the word sign as is used there means that God placed them as evidence pointing to the truth of something else. So the sun is not the true light. The sun points to the light that was on day one. That light is not the light of the sun. Are you with me? It seems to me that the light on day one didn't have to travel in a straight line because it's not limited. So when the light came on earth and engulfed the earth, why do I say that? What evidence do you have? Well, it says that the earth was dark. If the earth was dark, it means there was no sun. There is no sun, but water was on the face of the earth. It simply means that the water was frozen. Everybody all right there? And it says that God divided the waters and separate dry land from seas. It means the water must have melted. Are you with me? So the light of God must have engulfed all of the earth. But the light of the sun can only engulf half of the earth. Are you with me? So the sun is just a sign of the true light. Now, let us see if we can understand and put things together. Let's turn to the New Testament and let's look at Acts chapter 26. This is Paul giving his testimony before King Agrippa. And I want you to pay careful attention to what is being said. So let's see where the evidence leads and how, what means this light. Because we've discovered that there's a light that's not the sun and could even be brighter than the sun. Now, Acts chapter 26, I'm going to start from verse 12. If you're there, just say amen. Acts chapter 26, verse 12. Alright. Paul speaking for him. While thus occupied, as I journeyed to Damascus with authority and commission from the chief priests, at midday, O king, along the road I saw a light from heaven. Oh Lord. Brighter than the sun. Shining around me and those who journeyed with me. And when we had all fallen to the ground, I heard a voice speaking to me, saying in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the bricks or the walls. So I said, who are you, Lord? And what was the response to this and that man? Brighter than the sun. So now we know what light it was that predates the sun, brighter than the sun. Jesus himself said that, I am that light. In fact, Jesus himself said, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Why could Jesus make such a claim? Because he's not from here. He's from the heavens. Are you with me? And he is the true light that shines upon the earth to give light on the earth. Amen. I'm not talking about the light for plants, or the light for animals, or the light for rivers and streams. His light serves a different purpose. So we can acknowledge then that there is a light that is brighter than the sun, and that light, according to Jesus' own words, is Jesus himself. Amen. Hallelujah. And it says, but rise and stand, verse 16, on your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness, both of the things which you have seen and of the things which I will yet reveal to you. I will deliver you from the Jewish people as well as from the Gentiles to whom I now send you. Listen to this, verse 18. To open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. What a wonderful revelation, God. Wow. So it is the eyes that causes blindness. Didn't Jesus say the light of the body is the eye? And if your eye is single or perfect, then your whole body will be full of light. So light has come into the world, but in order for us to receive the light must come through our eyes. But if our eyes are blinded, Jesus says, great is that darkness. Why is that darkness great? Because the darkness is not outside of you. The darkness is inside of you. And when the darkness is inside, you don't even know at what you're stumbling. Are you with me? So the light is the faculty through which the body receives light. But remember, we're talking about spiritual things now. I don't mean figurative spiritual. No. It is not your physical eyes Jesus is alluding to. What way of seeing was Jesus talking about that his light could enter? Well, for that, write it down, 2 Corinthians 4, verses 3 to 6. Turn to it and make a note of it. And we'll be throwing up in a couple of minutes. So we understand that Jesus is light. He is the light of the world. But in order for us to receive light, light has to be focused through our eyes. 2 Corinthians 4, verses 3 to 6. The lamp of the body, the light of the body is the eyes. If the eye, is seeing, the body is full of light. And if not, the body is full of dark. 2 Corinthians 4, verses 3 to 6. Here it goes. But even if our gospel is veiled or hid, it is veiled to those who are perishing. Some translations, veiled to those who are lost. Whose mind, listen now, whose mind the God of this age has blinded. It seems to me that the mind is the faculty through which we see, not just the eyes. Are you with me? Because if the eyes were the only faculty of sight, then blind people would be hopeless. They couldn't do anything. They couldn't have vision. I mean, we have a blind member of parliament and he's accomplished so much. Even a PhD, he has written books. He's a minister of government. Many persons with two good eyes have not accomplished half as much. You can't say he has no vision because he can't see. Because vision is not dependent on physical eyes. It depends on inner sight. Are you with me? So here it says the God of this age has blinded the eyes of those who do not believe. Why? Lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. And verse 6 says, for it is God who commanded light to shine out of darkness. Same story. Who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So it is the mind that causes spiritual transformation. Paul says it this way, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. So the mind is a faculty of conformation to the ways of the world, or it's the faculty of transformation out of the ways of the world. And it is through the mind that the light of God enters. And that's the reason why the world seeks to capture your mind. Your mind and blind your mind so your mind is not open to the light of God. Everybody alright so far? Now, we're going to conclude by looking at John chapter 1. And we're talking about the second Sunday in Advent. It's about receiving the light that has come into the world. It's interesting to know that when you light a candle, if there is not something to sustain the light, like the wax, the light will just burn whatever it falls on. Now in the Old Testament, they used to use olive oil as a fuel for light. So as long as oil is in the lamp, then the wick will not be burnt. You can keep fire on something and it doesn't destroy the thing as long as oil or fuel is in it. Are you with me? And those things were a sign in the tabernacle or the temple. They had a seven lampstand, because menorah. And the Levites had to maintain it with 100% pure cold pressed olive oil. And it should never go out. Now, that oil that is poured in the lamp, in the tabernacle and the temple, is the same oil, the same holy oil that was used to anoint Aaron and his sons, the Levites, as priests. By the way, it's the same oil that is used when a prophet is going to anoint a king. Are you with me? So here's the thing. We read about the Spirit of God appearing, and when we read of the Spirit of God appearing, light came. It seems to me that wherever the Spirit of God is, light is there. Are you with me? Now, if you have light, there must be heat.
Yes.
Okay. Now, I don't know of any light that carries heat. That is not fire. That's not hot. Now, if you put light that carries heat, that is hot, on something that has no oil, it burns it to ash. Are you with me? It's the same thing. If you are going to receive the light of God and you don't have the anointing oil of His Spirit on you, it consumes you. And that's the reason why Jesus says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me. That's why the Spirit could rest on Him.
Hallelujah.
I never stopped to realize that when a king is going to be coronated, they pour oil on king's head. Yes, so the Spirit of God can rest on him. Do you remember the story of, I'm stretching your Bible now, you remember the story of Uzzah? When they were carrying the ark on the cart, and the ark was about to fall, and he touched it, burnt ash. Why? He was not of the tribe of Levi, who would have been anointed with oil. Are you with me? So this anointing is more than a figure, it's real. The Spirit of God rests and anoints us to carry His light. Now, when you look at John chapter 1, which we just read, so we won't need to go into all of it. It explains to us that in the beginning, the same beginning we read up in Genesis, was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now there's something very interesting about the book of John. And just make a note of it. John chapter 20, verse 30. John chapter 20, verse 30. We'll be out of here in a little time. Give us about 10 minutes, is that okay? John chapter 20, verse 30. If you're there, just say amen. John chapter 20, verse 30. And truly, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. That's the thesis of John's book. John says, surely Jesus did many other signs that are not written in this book. Hold on. Signs? Well, we read that the lights in the heaven were for signs. And here, John is saying that he has written signs that Jesus did. This Greek word signs is the Greek word semiotic. Or semion. And semion is the word from which we get the English word semiotics. And semiotics is the study of meaning and language. So a sign is something that points to something else. And as I explained earlier, that a sign usually points to something invisible. Are you with me? No. Jesus did many other signs that are not written in this book. It simply means that Jesus then, as far as John is concerned and is writing, Jesus must have been a heavenly light. Because that's where signs come from. That's what was given to us as signs. And so, we conclude with John chapter 1. It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This is the creation story being explained now. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and through Him nothing was made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. So, let me continue. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. It goes on to say, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to be a witness to the light, that all through him might believe. He was not the light. John was not the light. He was sent to be a witness of that light. To bear that the true light which gives light to every man who comes into the world. Verse 9, underline it, make a little bit, go home, meditate on it. That was the true light which gives light to every man who comes into the world. There is a light that gives light to every man that comes into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him. All of Genesis 1 through 3 was made through him. And the world did not know him. He came to his own. They did not even receive him. Listen to this now. But as many as received him, which is the light of the world, to them gave he power to become sons of God. How? Even to those who believe in his name. That's how you receive the light. That's how you receive the light that comes to light every man who is in the world. As many as receive him, you get power. The power to do what? To become sons. Now that's a very deep saying. It's a very deep thing. And it adds depth into Christmas. You know why? You mean, as many as received him, he gave them power to become children of God? This is what confuses Nicodemus. Because I'm an adult, and you're telling me, if I receive Jesus, I will get the power to become a child again. That's what he's saying. Are you with me? To as many as received him, to them he gave the power to become children of God. No human being has the power to become a child again. Are you with me? Nicodemus understood that and he was saying, how can this be? Can I go into my mother's womb a second time? Of course, the answer is no. He gave them the right to become the children of God, even to those who believe in his name. So it simply means that when you receive the light, this light that was there from the beginning, it gives you a new beginning also. You become a new creature. You're re-enacting the creation story in your life, because the light has now come inside of you. So when we receive the light, it's creation all over again. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. New creation. All things are passed away. And behold, all things become new. So brothers and sisters, you're not a sinner saved by grace. Scripture says you're a saint.
Hallelujah.
It's like somebody who has recovered from drug addiction and announced themselves, introduced themselves as a recovered drug addict. No, you're a normal person.
Hallelujah.
It's like somebody who was convicted of a crime and they come to introduce themselves as an ex-convict. No, you're a free person. The price has been paid.
Right.
Are you with me? So you cannot know sin is saved by grace. And we speak of that way as if we don't want to make ourselves too great. No, God made you greater by calling you sons, daughters, children. Are you with me? It behooves us then to walk worthy of that call. It's not to denigrate yourself, to say, I am not perfect. And God says, you must be perfect as I am perfect. You must be holy as I am holy. And John reveals something. He says that this birth is not by blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So when we receive the light of God, we receive the power to be born again as children of God. And that is the great evidence we have that the light still shines in our lives and in human beings' lives, in the lives of human beings today. That we can receive Him by faith, and by receiving Him, our lives can be transformed. We can become new creatures. We can become changed. So brothers and sisters, as we contemplate the second Sunday Advent, the coming of the light of God to the world, my question to you is, have you received the light? Have you received the light of God in your life? And if you have, are you putting a bushel over it? Are you setting it on a candlestick so it gives light to all who is in your room, in your vicinity? Jesus said it this way. Let your light so shine. Pause. Where are you going to get that light from? You have to get it from somewhere. You have to get it from someone. So He is the one that gives light. And having received His light, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. You realize what happened? Notice something, brothers and sisters. If your light is not shining, it can be doing good things, but nobody sees it. Why? It is the Spirit of God that reveals Himself to others. No one comes to God except His Spirit draws them to Him. So I can't come here and preach in my own name and my own power, my own authority. My good works will not be seen. It is when you allow yourself to be used by God that others will see what you are saying, see what you are doing, and so give glory, not to you, but to God in heaven. God wants us not just to receive His light, but to be transformed by His light, and also to make our light shine in a dark and sinful world.
Hallelujah.
Let us sing the hymn of response. There is a candle in every soul, some bright burning, some dark and cold. And there's a Spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes His home. And as we sing, brothers and sisters, if you have not yet received the light of God, which is Jesus Christ, this is the perfect opportunity to do so.